our voting system today is that it doesn't really reflect the votes that are cast are not really reflected well in Parliament. We see this happening over and over again. This past election in October, we saw that about 39% of the voters voted for the Liberal Party, yet the Liberal Party got some 54% of the seats in Parliament. So they've actually got a majority in Parliament with only 39% of the vote. And because they've got the majority in Parliament, they end up having 100% of the power. And oddly enough, that's exactly the same situation that we had in the previous government from 2011 to 2015, when Stephen Harper won with about 39% of the vote, got about 54% of the seats in Parliament, and ended up ruling with 100% of the power. So proportional representation aims to fix that. I'd like to use a slide here that I generated from statistics from Elections Canada that pertains specifically to Waterloo Region. And you can see here that these are the votes that were actually cast within the region. And I've just put them on here as a percentage of the total votes. And you can see that in Waterloo Region, the Liberal voters, there was actually about 43% of the votes cast, 43 to 45% that were Liberal. Yet, out of the five ridings in Waterloo Region, four of them, Cambridge, Kitchener-South Espaillat, Kitchener, and Waterloo, all have Liberal members of Parliament. The sole Conservative member is in Kitchener-Conestoga. The Conservatives only have the one seat out of the five electoral districts in Waterloo Region, even though they got almost as many votes overall in the region as the Liberals did. Yet they've only got one quarter of the representation. So that's not fair. But even worse, between the NDP, the Greens, the Libertarians, Marxist-Leninist, Animal Alliances, and an independent candidate, they had approximately 18% of the vote. That's, you know, about one-fifth. So out of five ridings, you would expect that there should be at least one NDP candidate elected to Parliament, yet that's not the case. A proportional system would fix that. I'll get into how it will fix that and the specific mechanisms a little bit later on in the talk. Waterloo Region is a great example for Canada as a whole. So in Canada at large, we see approximately the same distribution of votes, where, as I mentioned, the Liberals got only 43% of the vote, and Liberals and Conservatives together got about 72% of the vote, yet the Liberals got disproportionately large number of seats, and the Conservatives got was actually short-changed. They ended up getting fewer seats than they deserved based on the number of votes that they got. Even worse for the New Democrats. The New Democrats got about 20% of the votes and got only a small fraction of the seats, only about 13% of the seats. And then finally, Bloc Québécois is about correctly represented, but the Green members, who got about as many votes as the Bloc Québécois did, have only a single member of Parliament. So, we see exactly the same thing happening over and over again from election to election, where the number of votes that are cast in an election don't reflect the number of seats that actually exist in Parliament. Now, it is not just the parties and the number of votes that are disproportionate in Parliament. One of the biggest differentiators in Parliament is gender. In Canada, there's actually a majority of women. In the entire Canadian population, there's about 50.5% women and only 49.5% men. Yet in Parliament, fully three-quarters of the seats in Parliament are occupied by men, and only one-quarter are occupied by women. That's the current Parliament. Current Parliament has actually got a better gender balance than previous Parliaments had. And this, I believe, is a reflection of the voting system that we use that's disproportionate. Let me illustrate how that works. In Kitchener-Conestoga, as I mentioned, Harold Albrecht got just under 50% of the vote. He was very close. About 45% of the vote went to Harold Albrecht, which means that in that riding, the Kitchener-Conestoga riding, about 55% of the people voted against him. Yet, he is the only member of Parliament that was elected there. And the same sort of thing happened in the other four ridings, but this time for the Liberal candidate. In every case, the Liberal candidate got about 45% of the votes in the riding. And In every case, there was only one Liberal member elected in that riding. So we end up having four Liberal candidates with only 45% of the vote. This could happen over and over and over again in different jurisdictions and different electoral districts. And so it is entirely possible that with just, I don't know, we have four major parties in our parliament, so it's entirely possible that with only 26% of the vote, 1% more than one quarter, it's possible that one particular party could win every seat across the entire nation and end up completely occupying parliament with every seat occupied by that party, even though they only got 25 or 26% of the vote. So, it is my belief that if there were to be a proportional system, we would see better equality and gender balance. And that's actually proven out by other countries, New Zealand, and some of the newly formed countries, newly formed democracies. In almost every case when a new democracy is formed, a new country is created, a country is split, as Sudan has split into North and South Sudan. In almost every case, they choose to implement a voting system that's based on proportional representation. Almost no country anywhere chooses to select a first-past-the-post, a winner-take-all system, where a minority of the votes can actually result in that member being elected. So, in those countries, gender balance tends to be much better, and I believe that that's a result, not a direct result, and not a result that's mandated by law, but it's a result of having a proportional system. One of the ways of introducing a proportional system, a very unpopular way in Canada, is to have the parties determine who runs in their party ahead of time. So they actually create a list, usually with the party leader at the top of the list, the deputy party leader in the second position, cabinet ministers following that, and then the rest of the members of the rest of the candidates for that party listed by seniority. If it turns out that that party gets 30% of the votes in Parliament, the top 30% of that list would be assigned to seats in Parliament. It's very unpopular in Canada because if this applies across all of Canada, then there's a very legitimate question of who is my representative. Is it possibly the candidate who ran in British Columbia who has to represent somebody in Prince Edward Island? That doesn't be a very good geographic representation, and so that sort of system is actually never proposed for Canada. We have more regional systems that are proposed, but it's a good illustration of how a list system, where the lists are determined by the parties ahead of time, can be set up to provide good proportionality amongst gender representation. If, for example, on that list, every other member in the list, or the members of the list were alternating between men and women, then if you take the top 30% of that list, about half of them would be women. And so you get gender balance based on proportional system. That sort of thing could be mandated, could be made the law that a proportional system has to be gender balanced. But I don't believe that that would be a good thing to do. Any party that chooses to top load their list with all old white men is unlikely to get a great number of votes, especially from women, from young voters, and from non-white voters. Those proportions just don't represent Parliament if the list is entirely old white men and voters are as diverse as they are in Canada. So it's incumbent on the party to generate a list that is actually as diverse as the population itself to ensure that they get the maximum number of votes out of that list. Let's move on to another thing here, visible minorities. Now, it so turns out that based on the StatsCan information and the information from the last election, that the visible minority proportions are actually pretty darn close to the actual Canadian distribution of visible minorities. So we have about 18% non-white representation in the population across Canada, and that's about the same proportion of visible minorities that we have in Parliament. Country of origin is approximately proportionally represented as well. You can see that about 20% of Canadians are foreign-born, and just over, 12-13% of Parliament has their roots in different countries. So that's reasonably close, possibly not as good as it might be. But where we fall apart is in ethnic origin. Now, ethnic origin is defined by Statistics Canada as to where you believe your family originated. It's a self-selected thing in Statistics Canada. When you fill in the census form, you get to choose how you determine your ethnic origin. You can see that these are the choices that you can make on the census form. Now, there is no actual checkmark on a ballot to determine ethnic origin for parliamentarians, but you know, they tend to be a diverse lot anyway. The study that I read was from 2014, so from the previous government, the Conservative government from 2011 to 2014. So these statistics here actually represent that particular government. And you can see that approximately 80% of parliament at that time was considered white. And that compares to about 85% of Canadians who hail from the British Isles, North America, Europe, and French origins. Close to being equal, but you see some disparity in some of the other ethnic origins, where we have far more ethnic diversity in Canadian population than we have actually represented in Parliament. And again, I believe that having a proportional system would actually result in a proportional representation in Parliament based on ethnic origin and ethnic diversity as well. So, finally, the slide that brought me here is religion. Jihan said that the theme of today's event is religion versus politics. Well, I objected to that. I said this should be religion and politics. This is the representation of the admitted religious affiliation of parliamentarians. This actually includes both Parliament and the Senate, so 398 members in both the Parliament and Senate in the 2014 government. But only about one quarter of the people who were surveyed offered up their religious affiliation. So this bar here actually represents only 108 members who were interviewed. And you can see that religious diversity amongst that small group is way out of proportion to the religious diversity in Canada. It is entirely possible that a lot of parliamentarians, a lot of people in Parliament, did not want to divulge their religious orientation, possibly because they all fell into this group called none. And as Doug Thomas pointed out during the panel discussion a little bit earlier, this is a completely unrepresented bloc. The no religious affiliation is a completely unrepresented bloc amongst those parliamentarians that admitted their religious affiliation. Again, like I say, the three quarters that didn't divulge their religious affiliation may all have been none, but I suspect that's probably not the case. I'm going to guess that for those people who didn't divulge their religious affiliation, that very likely they fall in pretty much the same spectrum as those who actually did divulge. But you can see that other religions, the Jewish religion and the Muslim religion, are well overrepresented amongst those parliamentarians who admitted to their religious affiliation. How do we fix that? How do we actually get a representative religious spectrum in Parliament that compares favorably to Canada? And I think the solution to that is to have a proportional system. I said earlier that a block system, where the parties just choose the candidates that they can have on a very large list, is not very good for Canada. Canada is a very large country, really, really big. People in the north have completely different issues from people in urban areas. People in rural areas have different issues than people in maritime areas. The west coast has different needs than the east coast does. So it's very important to Canadians to have regional representation. In fact, it's actually a requirement of the Constitution. Each province is required to have a certain number of seats in Parliament as well. So we can't have a complete block open system. This is a system, a complete block system is what's used in Israel. And as Doug Thomas said, that can lead to fractious parliaments where small minority parties, fringe parties can actually hold sway in their parliament and cause all sorts of grief when legislation is trying to get passed there. That is not something that would work in Canada. Instead, I would propose that, going back to an earlier slide here, in Waterloo Region, for example, we lump all five existing electoral districts into one regional district that has five members in it. And if that should happen, members were actually elected to Parliament based on the votes that were cast across the entire region, then you would probably see two Liberal members going to Parliament, two Conservative members going to Parliament, and one NDP member going to Parliament just from within Waterloo Region. We would get that diversity in political parties. Now, I don't know if you recall the actual candidates who ran in Waterloo Region in the last election, but there's a very good chance that had the NDP been given a seat in Waterloo Region, that seat would have been occupied by a woman, because the NDP tends to run more women candidates than any of the other parties do. So we would see better gender representation in Waterloo Region. And very likely, we would see better ethnic and religious representation in Waterloo Region as well, because there's a larger spectrum of voters that are being represented in a proportional system. So, the entire country could be divided up into small regional districts. I think five electoral districts into one region is probably too small, because the larger your region is, the better the proportionality becomes. And you can see that if the entire country were one large region, we would have perfect proportionality based on that list system. And in a small district where there's only a single candidate running for one party, you have a completely disproportional system, so that doesn't work either. A good number that was suggested by the Law Commission of Canada in the report that was issued in 2004, they said, somewhere between 9 to 11 members of Parliament. And if you have 9 to 11 members of Parliament in a single region, then you can have a multi-member district that is as diverse in gender representation and ethnic representation and in religious representation as the actual spectrum is amongst Canadian voters as well. But I should have gone through that rather quickly. I was expecting all manner of questions from you. Are there any questions at this point? So we know that there is definitely a significant Sikh population in Canada. And you know from the 2015 Parliament that there's a significant number of Sikh members in Parliament. This is from the 2014 Parliament though, from the previous one, where there were also Sikh members, but during the survey that was taken for this study, it's a study by Kai Chan that he released in 2014, during his investigation, no parliamentarian who was of Sikh religion offered to give that religion. Now, it may be obvious to some people by looking at someone who is wearing a turban that this is very likely a Sikh person. But, unless they actually tell you, you can't really tell whether that's a Sikh turban or a turban from some other ethnic origin. So, yes, it's very interesting that this chart here does not represent any of the Sikh members of Parliament that I know existed in the 2014 government. Other questions? Voting in a multi-member district is usually done with a ranked ballot. So you get all the candidates listed on the ballot, and you have to number them in a 12-member district from 1 to 12. I defy anyone to tell me that Canadians aren't capable of counting from 1 to 12. A ranked ballot isn't that much more difficult than a single checkbox. Possibly 12 times more difficult because they put down 12 numbers on there. But I think Canadians are up to that. In fact, out of the 90 top countries in the OECD and across the world, only 4 countries of those 90 are not using a proportional system or a ranked system or a system where the members of Parliament actually reflect the number of votes cast. Those countries are Canada, the United Kingdom, Australia, and the United States. Every other country that's in the top OECD is using a proportional system. If they can all do it, certainly Canadians can as well. So it's not that much more complicated. Aside from a multi-member district, it's also possible to keep your local geographic representation. And during various information news that we have, as one you've got at the back there, we'll be at the Multicultural Festival, the Nonviolence Festival, various other street festivals during the year. And people say, I want a single member of Parliament to represent me. I don't want to have to choose from between 12 in the entire region. So there's actually a system of voting called the mixed member proportional, where it's divided up. So in the case of Waterloo Region, for example, where we have five current electoral districts, you want to keep the five members of parliament, but you might want to divide the entire region up into only three districts. Say we have Kitchener and Waterloo together, Kitchener, South Espler, and Cambridge together as one riding, and the three townships, Wilmot, Wellesley, and Woolwich, all together as electoral district as well. That leaves us with two additional members, two floating members, that could be used to adjust the proportionality of the vote based on the actual votes cast. So you would still have a winner-take-all system in each local electoral district, and if you lived in Kitchener-Waterloo, you would know exactly who your member of parliament is there. If you live in one of the townships, you would know exactly who your member of parliament is there. If you lived in Cambridge and Kitchener-South Espler, you would know exactly who your member of parliament is there, because only one member of parliament is elected for that particular electoral district. Yet the other two members of parliament could represent the entire region. So in the case of Waterloo Region, for example, let me just pop back to the Waterloo Region thing here. In the top three, first 60% of the votes then, if you're doing three out of five, you would probably end up getting two Liberal members and one Conservative member. That would probably be determined based on the actual votes cast in those three redistricted areas. And then the remaining two members, another Conservative member and possibly an NDP member, would be elected to be the floating members for all of the rest of Waterloo Region. So now you have the possibility, if you're an NDP voter, to actually go to your NDP member of parliament. That member may not be your local constituency member, but you still have an NDP member of parliament that represents Waterloo Region to go to. So proportionality works in that particular case for party affiliation. And as long as the proportionality is actually reflective of the votes cast, I believe that you'll see ethnic, gender, and religious diversity in those candidates then as well. And again, even with a mixed proportional member system, you'll see that the larger the districts are, the more accurate the proportionality will be overall. There's an interesting study in the gender diversity. It actually turns out that the Conservatives in the 2014 government, so Stephen Harper's government, actually had about 40% I think, of their members in Parliament were women, which is an exceptionally high percentage of members of Parliament to be in a Conservative government. Typically in Conservative governments you don't see that level of gender diversity. And even more so, in country of origin. Typically, in jurisdictions, you see it happening a lot in the US right now for the presidential election there, the Conservative Party, the Republicans, tend to be parties that are opposed to immigration, opposed to influx of new citizens. And so, a party like that is unlikely to accept a foreign-born candidate as one of their candidates to represent the party. And in fact, a foreign-born citizen is unlikely to want to be a member of the party that would have rejected them outright based on those party policies. So Canada is an unusual country in that, again, the Conservatives had a high number of foreign-born candidates in their caucus in the 2014 Parliament. So although Canada does quite well at country of origin and visible minorities, and even somewhat to some extent in ethnic origin, because of the voting system that we have today, which is a winner-take-all system, there's no guarantee that that's going to continue to exist. Whereas if a proportional system is to be implemented, there's actually a reasonably good chance that proportionality will also exist in gender, religion, and ethnic diversity. We have a marvelous opportunity right now to actually fix that, to actually have that happen. The Liberal campaign promise was to make the 2014 election the last first-past-the-post election that Canada would undergo. Now, they didn't actually come right out and say that they wanted to have a proportional representation system take over. They're leaving the door open to some other winner-take-all systems, such as alternative vote. But we have the opportunity right now to influence our own members of parliament. So write your member of parliament, give them a phone call, send them an email, make a visit to tell your Member of Parliament that you want to see proportional representation as the outcome of the study that they're about to do, that they, you want them to give serious weight to a proportional system for the electoral system that Canada wants, that the citizens of Canada want a proportional system. The only way that you'll be able to do that is to speak to your Members of Parliament. In this particular case, in Waterloo Region, we're fortunate that four out of the five members in Waterloo Region are actually members of the Liberal government and are likely to take your suggestions to the committee that has not yet been struck. We had the privilege of speaking to Harold Albrecht as a delegation from Verrote a few months back. And it was interesting that while the Conservatives held the majority in Parliament, Mr. Albrecht was completely opposed to any sort of proportional representation. Although he presented our petitions to Parliament, he made very clear that he was not in favor of proportional representation at all. But when we went to visit him in January, his tune had changed somewhat. Now that his party was underrepresented based on the number of votes that he got, he was actually more amenable to a proportional system and came right out and said that of all the systems, he would prefer to see one of the mixed member systems. So even if you're not in one of the Liberal districts, electoral districts that are represented by a Liberal member, go to see your Member of Parliament regardless, whether that's a Conservative member or if you're from another area altogether, whether that's an NDP member. Tell that Member of Parliament that you want to have a proportional system. And while they're not obligated to take that advice to task, if there's to be some hope of them being re-elected in a future election, they'll certainly take your advice to heart.
Harold Albrecht is now in the new riding, which was supporting him, and so he got elected in that riding because the majority of the people in that riding supported him.
No, the majority of the people in that riding voted against Harold Albrecht. He won with only 45% of the vote. He had more votes than the next guy, the Liberal candidate Tim Lewis, who had only 43% of the vote, but he had a minority. Most people voted against Harold Albrecht in his new riding.
I thought because it's more rural that he had the support.
He certainly had more support than the Liberals did. He certainly had more support than the NDP or the Greens, but he did not have the majority of support. Most people in the Kitchener-Conestoga riding voted against Harold Albrecht. And that's actually true for every member that was elected in Waterloo Region. Every single member was elected with a minority of the votes. The closest one that came to being a majority was Bardish Chagra in Waterloo. She had about 49% of the votes, which is still a minority. It still means that 51% of the people in Waterloo voted against Bardish Chagra.
But they didn't, they had several other options, and the other options didn't have enough support.
That's correct. And so in that case, anybody in the Waterloo riding who did not vote for Bardish Chagra did not get their representation in Parliament, because there's only one member for that entire riding. Bardish Chagra is it.
No, but don't you agree that the ethics of representation would now require, and I think I know Bardish personally, she will represent all her riding now. She's not going to pick on people on one. Oh, you're Liberal and you're not.
Sure. So if it comes to filling out a citizenship form or facilitating getting a passport, she is a Member of Parliament who could make that happen. She will do so equally for all members in her riding, for all her constituents.
But when it comes to assume this integrity, right?
And I certainly believe that every single Member of Parliament who's been elected will have that level of integrity, that they will do the facilitation for immigration papers or any of the other paperwork that needs to be done. But if you go to a Member of Parliament with a policy idea that is entirely opposite to what that party stands for, then that Member of Parliament is not going to adequately represent you in Parliament. Because their ideas, their reason for being in the party that they're in, or their reason for having run with their particular philosophy, is contrary to the ideas that you want to represent. In a multi-member district, you have the choice of which member you want to go to. So if there is, if you have conservative ideas that you want to bring to Parliament, it does you no good at all to go to a Liberal member and say, I want you to vote for the Conservative policies. That doesn't happen. But if you have a choice of the different members in a multi-member district, then you can say, I want to go to my Conservative member of Parliament and tell that Conservative member, I want you to vote for anti-immigration laws, if that's the kind of thing that you want to stand for.
Do you also identify that there is another problem, a bigger problem, which is that people, or at least all the elected, will toe the line of a party, not listen yes. to their own writing?
Those are the whipped votes. It is a terrible shame of Canadian democracy that whipped votes even exist in Parliament. A whipped vote is when a party has a particular policy and all the members of Parliament are told by a person who's called the party whip how to vote. If they choose to disregard that, if they choose to vote against what that member of Parliament has said, they could very well be kicked out of the party. Certainly, they cannot be a member of the cabinet, you know, they can't be a minister of anything if they choose to vote against a party policy. And yeah. So, if you are a member, if you are a citizen in a district that's being held by a member of Parliament who happens to be in cabinet, as citizens in Waterloo are, it is exceptionally unlikely, it is impossible, in fact, that Bardish Chagger will ever vote against party lines on anything. Because she's a member of cabinet, she's obligated to vote that way.
And I see that as a major problem.
It certainly is. I completely agree with that. So, to toot my own horn for just a half a second here, the Green Party has a policy of no whipped votes ever. And it's an unusual thing. If you look at the number of free votes that exist in Parliament, where the party whip gives the members permission to vote their conscience, to vote how they want to vote. It actually turns out that one of the more progressive parties, the NDP party, the National Democratic Party, has the largest number of whipped votes in Parliament of any of the parties that exist. The Conservatives have more free votes than the NDP does. That's just an unusual thing. And I think that's from the history of the previous government, where the Conservatives had a majority of the seats in Parliament, so they could afford to waste a few votes on free votes that didn't go in the party direction. You know, so they could be generous with the surplus of seats that they had compared to the number of votes that they got. But yes, I completely agree with you that the whole idea of whipped votes, where the citizens' ideas, the representation that the citizens expect from their member of Parliament, is not being honored because the member of Parliament is voting how the party tells him or her to, not how the constituents tell that member of Parliament to vote. That is a very big deficit in Canadian democracy.
To be fair, because I did have this discussion recently, in a particular situation about 2 weeks ago, the Liberals did allow their members to vote freely. They did not impose a party line.
Yes. That happens sometimes. That doesn't happen always.
Maybe this is the change that's going to happen.
I don't believe so. I think that as long as parties exist, I think you will see party whips. Especially in the larger parties that have a very set philosophy, that are very much rooted in one portion of the political spectrum. So a right-wing party, a party on the right side of the political spectrum, is unlikely to ever allow all votes to be free votes, because there are certain things that get voted on that are completely contrary to conservative ideals. So for example, the issue of a woman's right to control her body, the abortion issue, the idea of free marriage between same-sex couples. Those are completely contrary to conservative ideals. And I don't think that the Conservative Party would ever allow those sorts of votes in Parliament to be free votes. Those will always be whipped votes, where it's something that is definitely part of the party's policy. In fact, in the Liberal Party itself, the statement has been that Liberal members will actually have free votes on any issue that is not party policy, That's contrary to the Canadian Constitution or Charter of Rights and Freedoms and
campaign.
And anything that's contrary to a campaign promise. So between those three issues, campaign promises, legal issues, and policy statements, there's very little left to vote on that could be a free vote. Proportional representation, electoral reform, is one of them, because all that the Liberal Party promised to do is to look at and study and come up with a solution. They haven't actually committed to any one particular electoral system, so that will be a free vote. But that's because it doesn't fall under any of those three issues.
Don't you think that's fair, though, because they got elected on that platform, so they have to respect it?
They only got elected with 39% of the vote. They didn't get elected with 54% of the seats. They got 54% of the seats, but that doesn't reflect the votes that they got. It doesn't reflect the will of the Canadian people at large. And because they've got the majority, they do have the ability to sway the votes in the House of Commons. If that vote is whipped, they can completely ignore any of the votes against them from all the other parties combined, because they have the majority. They have 54% of the seats. So all the other parties ganging up against them would only account for some 46%. They will win every parliamentary election that they choose to win. And that does not reflect how Canadians voted for them.
I had great concerns about Bill C-24, which instantly turned me into second degree citizen. And
exactly.
I had even more concerns about the C-51. And unfortunately, the Conservatives are the ones who had used their majority to push things like
exactly.
that. And I'm still trying to rationalize how the system in Canada and the Constitution allowed them to meddle with such critical issues.
Yes, it's because of the electoral system. The voting system that we use allows that to happen. Allows that to happen legally.
No, isn't it a conflict with the Constitution?
No, it is not. There's no constitutional requirement for there to be proportionality in Parliament.
No, I'm not talking about proportionality. I'm talking about the whole attitude about the fact that you can just write off people who have been living in Canada for maybe 28 years or 50 years or whatever at the whim of somebody
right.
and reduce them to a second level. Why isn't that in the charter?
I believe that it is in the charter. That was a violation of the charter.
So why isn't that being cancelled? Like why wasn't that challenged and not passed as a law?
Well, it could not get, it had to be passed because a majority of Conservatives voted for that to be passed.
But
and in fact, as it turns out, many of the other parties just followed along and voted for that anyway.
Well, why was it introduced? This is something that you don't mess with, then you don't introduce it for votes.
Well, the thing is that even though the majority of Canadians would have rejected that legislation, the makeup of Parliament allowed that non-constitutional law to be passed. Based on our adversarial judicial system, somebody has to mount a court challenge in order for this to be determined non-constitutional or against the Charter of Rights. That costs a lot of money.
You're still allowed to pass a law that is unconstitutional?
Until it is proven to be unconstitutional, It's a legally passed law by Parliament of Canada. So until the courts determine that it's unconstitutional, it isn't. It's the law of the land until it's proved otherwise.
That's playing games here.
It certainly is. And so had we had a proportional system when that law was up for debate, Canadians, as a majority of Canadians, would probably have voted against that. And so the representatives for that majority of Canadians should have voted against such a law. But because the seats in Parliament don't properly reflect the votes that were cast, the majority of Canadians' will for that law to be defeated was not honored in Parliament. Perfectly legally and completely contrary to any principle of honor or ethics.
So is
Mr.
There
Thomas
a,
has
is
a question.
Is there actually, just a second.
I just want to clarify something.
I just
Constitution.
I just want to offer something. Is there a way now to kind of secure what is in the charter? Okay, that it does not come unless there is a proper referendum instead of a vote in parliament.
No, there's no. The only constitutional requirement for electoral reform is that the constitutional.
No, I'm talking about those bills.
Well, those bills. Well, yeah, yes, yeah. With a court challenge. So if you want to sue the government, saying that they have passed a law that is contrary to the Constitution or contrary to the Charter of Rights, and you can win such a court case, when you win that court case, then that law will be overturned and things will be back to decency. But until that happens, that's not the case. The law of the land today says that Canadians can be stripped of their citizenship if they have dual citizenship. Now, I understand that the Liberal government today is trying to overturn that law based on another parliamentary bill or a parliamentary motion. So it may come to pass without a court challenge, but that's only because the current government has to undo an awful lot of the legislation that was enacted in the previous government.
And I would think that one should be working towards securing certain things that should not be messed with.
And the majority of Canadians agree with you that those things should not be messed with. Parliament doesn't. Go ahead, Mr. Thomas.
Okay, I wanted to clarify something about the Constitution that most people miss. Our Constitution, and just so you know, my whatever education I have is constitutional history. So the Constitution that evolved through the British system recognizes a significant flaw in writing the Constitution. The United States covers this by having an amendment system, which we somehow have managed to do. But the Constitution doesn't just consist in things like the Charter of Rights and Freedoms or the Constitution Act of 1867, which I'm old enough to know as the DNA Act of 1867, or the Manitoba Schools, all of those things. Now, the other part of it is case law, which is what Michael was talking about. And the reason that it's evolved that way is that it is virtually impossible to write a constitution that will fit all of the variations and possibilities. Constitutions are cast in generalities, okay? So our Charter of Rights and Freedoms, for example, says nothing about freedom from religion. But case law, namely a case in 1984 where a drug retail company objected to the New Brunswick Lord's Day Act, and that worked its way through in the Supreme Court of Canada, ruled in the favor of the drug retail company, said it's impossible to have freedom of religion without having freedom from religion. Because if you force everybody to have religion, then that's not freedom of religion. So that's how it evolved. So Gahan's concern is that we do, from time to time, pass legislation, which is later judged to be unconstitutional. Sometimes it's much later. But the problem is, if you try to write a constitution that avoids that action, then you get a constitution that is so inflexible that, and so specific, and the minute you start getting specific in constitutions, then loopholes and exceptions and everything else happen. So the process is that a law like that, the Deportation Act, the C-24, right? Which, by the way, my daughter, who happened to be Jewish, pointed out that if she decided, if somebody identified her as a terrorist, she could be deported, because she legally can go to Israel and say, I want to be an Israeli citizen, so she in effect has dual citizenship. Crazy act, very, very simplistic, and so on. But on the other hand, you can't, the act of having that challenge, that's the way it has to work. I know Bob wants to tell you the proportional representation of print. I'm not entirely sure it will, although the concept of proportional representation is basically liberal. The thing is that's, if you want to understand our Constitution and how it works, you have to include case law in the mix. And sometimes that creates a problem. It's why we can't necessarily get all the things we want right away. way. And you have, case law is not easy to do. You can't just sue the Canadian government. You have to prove that it affects you negatively, whatever that law is, okay? So we had a lady who tried to challenge the funding of the separate school system beyond grade 8, and went to the Human Rights Tribunal because that's all based on that funding to grade 8, based on the Scott Act, which was passed before Confederation. She was denied a hearing because it didn't affect her personally. She didn't have standing. And that's maybe a flaw in our system, but on the other hand, it prevents a whole bunch of litigation, such as the stuff that goes on in the United States. So that's, when we talk about things like the Constitution and the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, we have to remember that it evolves through case law. And some of that case law is centuries old, but it's an important part of the Constitution.
So, are there any further questions on proportional representation, diversity, religion? If not, then that's the end of my presentation. And I thank you very much for being here today.